Most Holy Father and Lord, we know, and from the chronicles and books of the ancients we find that amongst other nations our own, the Scots has been graced with widespread renown. They journeyed from Greater Scythia by way of the Tyrrhenian Sea and the Pillars of Hercules, and dwelt for a long time in Spain amongst the most savage tribes, but nowhere could they be subdued by any race, however barbarous. Thence they came, 1200 years after the people of Israel crossed the Red Sea, to their home in the west, where they still live today. The Britons they first drove out, the Picts they utterly destroyed, and even though very often assailed by the Norwegians, the Danes, and the English, they took possession of that home with many victories and untold efforts, and, as the historians of old time bear witness, they have held it free of all bondage ever since. In their kingdom there have reigned 113 kings of their own royal stock, the line unbroken by a single foreigner. The high qualities and deserts of these people were not otherwise manifest gained glory enough from this, that the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our Lord Jesus Christ, after his passion and resurrection, called them, even though settled in the uttermost parts of the earth, almost the first to his most holy faith. Nor would he have them confirmed in that faith by merely anyone, but by the first of his apostles, by calling through second or third in rank, the most gentle St. Andrew, the blessed Peter's brother, and desired him to keep them under his protection as their patron forever. The most holy fathers, your predecessors, gave careful heed to these things and bestowed many favours and numerous privileges on this same kingdom and people, as being the special charge of the blessed Peter's brother. Thus our nation, under their protection, did indeed live in freedom and peace up to the time when that mighty prince, the King of the English, Edward, the father of the one who reigns today, when our kingdom had no head and our people harboured no malice or treachery, and were then unused to wars or invasions, came in the guise of a friend and ally to harass them as an enemy. The deeds of cruelty, massacre, violence, pillage, arson, imprisoning prelates, burning down monasteries, robbing and killing monks and nuns, and yet other outrages without number which he committed against our people, sparing neither age nor sex, religion nor rank, no one could describe nor fully imagine unless he'd seen them with his own eyes. But from these countless evils we have been set free by the help of him who, though he afflicts, yet heals and restores, by our most tireless prince, king and lord, the Lord Robert. He, that his people and his heritage might be delivered out of the hands of our enemies, met toil and fatigue, hunger and peril, like another Maccabeus or Joshua, and bore them cheerfully. Him too, divine providence, his right of succession according to our laws and customs, which we shall maintain to the death, and the due consent and assent of us all have made our prince and king. To him, as to the man by whom salvation has been wrought unto our people, we are bound both by law and by his merits that our freedom may still be maintained, and by him, come what may, we mean to stand. Yet, if he should give up what he has begun and agree to make us or our kingdom subject to the King of England or the English, we should exert ourselves at once to drive him out as our enemy and a subverter of his own rights and ours, and make some other man who was well able to defend us our king. For as long as but 100 of us remains alive, never will we, on any conditions, be brought under English rule. It is, in truth, not for glory nor riches or honours that we are fighting, but for freedom, for that alone, which no honest man gives up, but with life itself. Therefore it is, Reverend Father and Lord, that we beseech your holiness with our most earnest prayers and suppliant hearts, inasmuch as you will, in your sincerity and goodness, consider all this, that since with him, his vice-regent in earth, you are, there is neither weighing nor distinction of Jew and Greek, Scotsman and Englishman. You'll look upon with the eyes of a father on the troubles and privation brought by the English King upon us and upon the Church of God. May it please you to admonish and exhort the King of the English, who ought to be satisfied with what belongs to him, since England used once to be enough for 7 kings or more, to leave us Scots in peace who live in this poor little Scotland, beyond which there is no dwelling place at all, and covet nothing but our own. We are sincerely willing to do anything for him, having regard to our condition, that we can to win peace for ourselves. This truly concerns you, Holy Father, since you see the savagery of the heathen raging against the Christians, as the sins of Christians have indeed deserved, and the frontiers of Christendom being pressed inward every day, and how much it will tarnish your holiness's memory if, which God forbid, the church suffers eclipse or scandal in any branch of it during your time, you must perceive. Then rouse the Christian princes who for false reasons pretend that they cannot go to help of the Holy Land because of wars they have on hand with their neighbours. The real reason that prevents them is that in making war with their smaller neighbours they find quicker profit and weaker resistance. But how cheerfully our Lord the King and we too would go there if the King of the English would leave us in peace. He from whom nothing is hidden well knows, and we profess and declare it to you as the Vicar of Christ and to all Christendom. But if your holiness puts too much faith in the tales the English tell, and will not give sincere belief to all this, nor refrain from favouring them to our prejudice, then the slaughter of bodies, the perdition of souls, and all the other misfortunes that will follow, inflicted by them on us, and by us on them, will, we believe, be surely laid by the Most High to your charge. To conclude, we are, and shall ever be, as far as duty calls, ready to do your will in all things as obedient sons to you, his vicar, and to him as the supreme king and judge we commit the maintenance of our cause, casting our cares upon him and firmly trusting that he will inspire us with the courage and bring our enemies to naught. May the Most High preserve you to his holy church in holiness and health and grant you length of days. Given at the monastery of Arbroath in Scotland on the 6th day of the month of April in the year of grace 1320 and the 15th year of the reign of our King aforesaid.